know Scott Butler, who is talking on educational anarchy, the hermeneutic development of transpersonal education from an international perspective. Scott is a senior lecturer in education at University of Worcester, primary school teacher by training. He's gravitated to applied psychology, and he's currently working as an applied psychology, working on an applied psychology textbook for teachers. So very active in the area. I know Scott because he's a graduate of the program we ran at Liverpool John Moores University in consciousness and transpersonal psychology. And just to say that I think he's the only person, I know who was studying for an MSc at the same time as doing a PhD. A glutton for punishment.
Thank you.
And you were successful in
Sorry. Just about. Sorry.
Okay. We look forward to hearing it.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for turning up. If you're a fan of Have I Got News to You, we're going to have a little quiz. absolutely no prizes whatsoever. Same as a couple of these of you. What I'd like you to do is either just call it out, or if you feel a bit shy, write it down on a piece of paper. What do you think the missing word is?
Gove.
Gove. Brilliant. Any other advances in that?
Exams.
Yeah, very close. VCSAs. Sorry, these are all proper headlines. Squeeze the URL at the bottom of them, etc. Just to prove I'm not making these up. Do that. Okay, let's try the next one.
Anybody they like?
Got it in one thing you got. Academy schools can now hire and qualify teaching staff. Now, of course, this announcement was made at 3 p.m. on the day of the Olympics opening ceremony. Yeah. And okay, that was in August. Let's take it a bit further. Another dog's dinner of the plan for exam reform.
No.
You would not be wrong in that. It's the English Baccalaureate. And last but not least,
go.
This is a really simple quiz.
It's a Sunday morning, it was a late night last night. It's
pupils,
yes. any other advances? Okay, it was actually Facebook. Playing along, so that was a few minutes of my presentation. It's resume, go downhill from there. I guess the people can be quite cynical of education. I mean, thankfully, it's the last day of September today, 1st of October tomorrow. That means education will stop hitting the headlines. It'll be the nurses next, or the health service, believe me. That's what happens tomorrow. Not on a media study. Well, yeah, media studies, that's part of education studies, yeah. Run modules on TV and stuff. Taking a Fordistic view of education, quite a few cynics within the education, not on one of those, would say that education has become a conveyor belt. Children come in, we do something to them, we continue to test them for quality, and then we spit them out the other side. In fact, some of these spaz out into teacher training colleges, and they get on another conveyor belt of being indoctrinated in how to deliver the curriculum in the government's prescribed way. Did I say that? This is being recorded, isn't it? I'm not going to sign that statement now, but okay, I'm changing my name to they're on a new conveyor belt, and that's quite a negative way. So, all I've done this morning is knock education. There's enough people knocking that. There was a rallying call to arms last year that I watched on YouTube, of all things. I didn't actually get to the conference last year, but Mike Daniels did a wonderful talk about the future of transpersonal psychology. And one of the concluding messages was to take transpersonal psychology and to apply it in a wider context. And that resonated here, because for a few years I was sort of, where am I going, what am I doing? And then this conference came along, thought, okay, summit courage, let's put in a paper, and let's try and combine where I'm going professionally and where I'm going in my academic take. So the theme of conference is the combination of science and art, and we've seen many wonderful presentations talking and advocating about art, and we've seen some wonderful displays of art, and also the scientific taking place, maybe just there, looking at the subject. Now, the primary school teacher in me has united these two together to synthesize, if you want to make it sound broadly academic. So from my educational perspective, I've combined this. Very good. The science is what some cynics would say is teaching by numbers. For example, every lesson has to have a WALT and a WILF. I'm not going to ask you for those acronyms, but a WALT, so I'm not written down somewhere here, we are learning too. So at the beginning of the lesson, you have your WALTs on the board. Children, today we are learning too. And then we have the WILFs. What I'm looking for as a teacher, what I'm looking for is. That starts off the lesson. Then you go into the standard introduction, development, progression, and then conclusion, or in education terms, we like to call it a plenary for some reason. But that has stifled creativity within the classroom. I'm sure that many of us who've been in compulsory education didn't have teachers going through the waltz of widths, but arguably it's what upstairs are looking for. And it's framing a lesson in a certain way, and people like to keep in that comfort. So we can say that it's teaching by numbers. On the art side, I would say that teaching, very much like research, is tricky. It comes from within. You've got to have a passion in something. You can't just teach from a textbook. You've really got to embrace the art and philosophy of teaching. So that's my very tender snippet again into how it's favourite place to some extent to his novels. So as an overview, I'm going to tell you about the research I've been conducting, what transpersonal education is, the findings, and tell you where I'm going next with this. And then I'd be really open to any suggestions in how I can take this further. So obviously, transpersonal psychology stemmed from the psychology of humanistic psychology, Maslow, and Link saying that it's transpersonal psychology should pursue humanistic psychology. But also, he was the first person to use the term positive psychology. Now, if we take both branches of psychology, we could say there's a sibling rivalry going on. There's many areas of similarity, but as we may know, there's some areas of tensions as well. So, for example, today I started by talking about the idea, before we can go to the Zen, that balance there. In terms of the sibling rivalry, maybe it's summarised in the question, how many positive psychologists does it take to change a light bulb? One, but the light bulb has got to want to change. How many transpersonal psychologists does it take to change a light bulb?
None.
Exactly. One.
Because we do it without moving.
Well, that's but none, because the light bulb exists only in his own mind. Also, I'm sure you can come up with a better punchline than that, so you know, if you start ripping off the drinks, please come on stage.
Light bulb is perfect as it is.
Oh, well. Now, ultimately, we can take all three and say, yeah, the uniting theme is inertia. Transformation, which Ken Clow was doing a wonderful input on just moments ago. So, how does this stem into transpersonal education? According to Rothbard and Cunningham, education is one of the most significant areas for future inquiry and exploration within transpersonal psychology. Yet to date, there's been very little research in that area. Now, when I'm talking about transpersonal education, I'm not talking about graduate or postgraduate courses, I'm talking about compulsory education. From my research, it's spanned the extent of the two textbooks that were written in the early 1970s on transpersonal education, and since then there seems to have been an absence in how the transpersonal may be related to also the form, the compulsory side of education. So, taking these, blowing the dust off the books and saying, well, how can this be revisioned in the 21st century, 2012? What does it mean? Do any of these themes still relate? And arguably, yes, they all do. We'll have a look at some of those. Now, throwing in an educationist is Ralph Tyler. Ralph Tyler spoke about developing the curriculum through three approaches. But within the curriculum, you need to have policies that underpin it, the principles that are central to this, and then of course the practices. What do you actually do? Let's take the policies. Now, various authors suggest transpersonal education should combine the various domains of being. If we take Benjamin Bloom's work, most educationists know only about the cognitive side, but of course Bloom's taxonomy of learning, we've got cognitive, the affective, the psychomotor. In terms of, say, teachers and education, a lot is written about this one, very little about the other two. Surely the transpersonal education should unite the whole of the domains of being. It shouldn't just be job impulse. It should be integrated. And through that integration comes personal transformation. Now, according to Maslow, uniting these domains and the purpose of education is to enable the child to become healthy, to become self-actualized, although obviously Maslow's later work was self-actualization. The hierarchy of needs, so fundamental to teachers, to nurses, to business studies, maybe to psychology students. But most teachers, the only thing they know about Maslow is the hierarchy of needs and very little outside of that. This all centres upon effective education from both parents and teachers. What prevents parents and teachers conveying their own distorted patterns of behaviour onto those that they're working with? This is something that Berman Gila called primal wounds. Now, Berman Gila was saying that really, before we let loose of children, we ought to undergo our own course of therapy. And it's something that I maintain before a teacher's let loose in the classroom, that they should actually know themselves first before trying to know 30 children. It's maybe quite a contentious issue, maybe, Bruce, I was thinking. But if you think about the teachers who you've experienced within your life, there'll be those who resonate with profound awe, and those who may fall into a different category. One of the cathartic exercises we do with our first year ed study students is get them to write an educational autobiography about one critical incident in their education. And it's amazing what comes out and how they then analyse that. So parents and teachers need to resolve their own primal wounds to move towards their own personal transformation before working with children and enabling them with their transformation. So, from the policies, there's a series of principles. Literature identifies a number of general principles that would resonate with teachers. The general principles that come from the literature on transpersonal education is that education should be joyful. Really? We can't have that in schools. It should be intrinsic. We should learn because we want to, not because we're being tested on it. A sense of autonomy, a sense of independence, the joy of self-discovery. Not imposing any of our own values on children we work with. But it should be more a process of facilitation, something we're familiar with in higher education, but not necessarily so within the school set. And also, that transpersonal education should indeed be lifelong. If we take some of these further, one area that's engaged with increasing frequency is the notion of forest school. Forest school, a wonderful aspect for my European cousins, that you have an area of open space, but you have children who say, go and play. I'm a teacher, stands back. Forest school is a philosophy. You can be trained in it, but ultimately it needs to resonate within you. Yet, I've seen and I've heard about teachers who impose their own views on children playing in a natural environment. Don't climb that, you're getting mud everywhere, you shouldn't put your boots on, you're going to have to wash your hat. And the notion of forest school, this notion of natural exploration, is stifled somewhat. Relating to the specific principles within a transpersonal education, the notion of having inner depths, of being able to explore, being able to explore ourselves and who we are. The noetic notion of awe and beauty, seeing the interconnection of everything. That unitive experience. Being open to experience, taking that experience and embracing it and living it and taking its course. And indeed, relating to practice. In terms of practices, a I've taken these from Roger Walsh's work, Seven Spiritual Practices, that he argues are perennial to every spiritual transpersonal philosophy. That the transpersonal education could be informed by redirecting motivation. To that extent, this means reducing our craving, looking for the intrinsic as opposed to the extrinsic notion of reward. Transforming our emotions, trying to limit fear, trying to limit anger. And what resonated with Chloe's presentation was how this can be so wrapped up. And that it's through therapy that this comes out, that we can transform these emotions that we may have suppressed for many years. Living ethically. Getting on well with each other. Getting on well with the environment. Surely, as a teacher, would love to have develop concentration with their children, with themselves. But developing concentration and refining awareness. Taking deep learning and applying that to practice is cultivating wisdom. And then the notion of service and generosity. So, the seven perennial practices that Walsh talks about in his book, we could say that overarching all of those is the notion of self-transcendence. Yeah, how can this happen? It's great theorizing about education. One of my theories about education is it doesn't fit in a circle, a square, or a triangle. It's not a theory of education. We can take transpersonal, we can embed it within existing subjects. So, obviously ones like art, obviously ones like education, maybe even physical education. We could examine the transpersonal. Alternatively, we could bring new activities into the curriculum. Or rewrite the curriculum completely. New curriculum rewrites is coming up very soon. The curriculum changes every 3.75 years, which keeps teachers on their toes, perhaps their students as well. So, this is an aspect that Moore is discussing, that we could take one of these, we could take a transpersonal, we could embed it within the compulsory schooling this way. This leads me into what actually is research. So it's great theorising about this, but how can we put it to practice? I can't remember who was speaking yesterday about how we make up terms, but here's a new term that I've just been playing around with, the 360 degree metaphorology. It's a circle. Do I say that circle is supposed to practice? So let's take the notion of transpersonal education. I've theorised about it for the last 20 minutes. But we need to explore that. In other words, do these themes resonate with other educationists? So by conducting the survey and looking at those themes that have been identified and see the extent the teachers and teacher trainees agree with that, leads to some quantitative number crunch. From there, we can explore. We can try to explain those stats and explain those through a more qualitative phase. Explain those perhaps through through questionnaire, through interview, through focus groups. And finally, evaluate those findings to perhaps rewrite transpersonal education and repeat that cycle again. Now, my research has really focused on this quantitative phase. In other words, have I got an idea? Has it got any credibility? Does it resonate with anyone? So I went to a survey in London last year, a wonderful name for a survey, LICE, the London International Conference of Education. Not a very good CV opportunity, I have to say, but a wonderful place where many, many people from different countries have to discuss education. And I dipped my toes very gently in the water with a similar input to the first part to say, well, look, am I barking up the wrong tree? And I was quite overwhelmed by the amount of people who said, that is wonderful. that there are themes that they're trying to develop, no matter what corner of the world they came from. That there are things that they feel should be in place. So it's great hearing that from your conference delegate, but what does that convey in practice? So there are 105 delegates at the conference, and contacted all of those with an online survey utilised through free online surveys, which costs £10 a month. So maybe a misnomer there. But anyway, the sample. A very high sample. Remember my GCSE grade 3 in English doesn't go very far in translating it into different languages. So thankfully the people responding. I take a good understand for English and some of the concepts that I was discussing. 12 different countries across 5 continents, predominantly Europe. The teaching experience ranged quite significantly. But in essence, the themes that they were coming up with did resonate, they did engage with the questionnaire, and I've had quite a few emails since. Now, the scale of reliability gave a 0.89 on 19 items, so yeah, reasonably okay, quite happy with that. In terms of policies, 3 questions are asked. The extent towards the way that the domains are being psychomotor, affective, cognitive, are united. How does that relate to your education system? The largest sector saying we should continue to work on that. The lowest, but very few education systems actually combine those at all. Or they may be equally promoted, but made as separate subjects and not this notion of integration. But I've read these in order about the principles. What was quite interesting was the principle for school lowest as being value-free. The response was, well, you can't really have an education system that's value-free. We'll still impose our own values, whether consciously or subconsciously. But in essence, those first 4 or 5 or 6 or 7, they're quite grouped together. But their themes, the respondents agreed or strongly agreed with on a 5-point scale. In terms of practices, the results on the sample indicated in order that this notion of cultivating wisdom is fundamental, along with finding others. Maybe there's some overlap with this. The next phase really needs to explore why. Why the people who are here? All I can do is muse at the moment about this. But I need to do this further qualitative stage, asking why. Where should transpersonal education come? Predominantly, looking at the curriculum, looking at the existing subjects, and finding ways that we can make cross-curricular links to the transpersonal. Now, I take it from the sample that very, very few have actually heard of the notion of a transpersonal. Even with colleagues at Worcester, I mutter it under hushed tones. But when you get talking to them, they say, wow, that really resonates. A conversation with a play therapist, Mandy, who works in the early childhood studies sector. It's just written a book on play, and the themes are just, we're talking the same language. We talk to early years practitioners, if we talk to teachers, yes, they've got this core philosophy here, and they don't know what it is. And then when you start talking about transpersonal, they say, that's it. They're finding a home in this field, a field that they don't realise exists. And this is something which I and others need to do. I was talking about the factory system of regurgitating out teachers. I had a wonderful joke with Alison the other day about psychometrics being used to screen teachers before they're even allowed onto a teacher training course. So we'll have the interviews, we'll have the presentations, etc., the group discussions. Oh, and here, please be filling a psychometric. I'm wondering why. Are we trying to find one size teacher who fits all? Because I certainly haven't found one child who is the same as any other in my teaching experience. Are we trying to generate a clone of teachers? Or are we trying to find a way that we can counsel teachers through perhaps use of psychometrics to encourage their professional development? If any of you are versed in psychometrics, four big companies are charging £50 a pop, which is almost a £40 clear profit for each person who fills one in. So I'm not telling you to go out there and make money on doing psychometrics, but I'm sure that you could talk to your local teacher training department and find a way in. So where next? What can we do from here? The theme of alliteration, which I'm sort of picking up on in this presentation for our conference, I've got the 3A approach. Apply research. Taking this, taking it forward, getting people talking about this. And in terms of using the qualitative phase, which in November I'll be going to the Rice Conference again to talk to some of the people I met last year to find out why the themes resonated with them. This may well lead into a new research cycle and a wider investigation of international perspectives, because let's face it, folks, 45 people is a considerably small sample, but it indicates that there's still some momentum going forwards. Advocacy. Talking to colleagues on a one-to-one basis and developing people who've got like-minded interests or trying to find common ground is one such aspect. Education conferences. It's something which I'm stepping slightly into more so now to advocate transpersonal. And trying to shape the perception of anyone who I work with on a day-to-day basis at the university. By subtly bringing in these themes, subtly writing chapters of textbooks that talk about transpersonal education and why it's such a good idea. So there's 2 A's there, and the 3A approach. And very tenuous there. Very, very tenuous. I don't know. The 3A, the notion of educational anarchy. Yes, a lot of the nation of anarchists. Now, anarchy, going back to those images at the beginning, we can think, oh, that was anarchy, that was chaos, perhaps last summer, etc. But according to Greenberg, most academics, especially within education, have only the vaguest idea of what anarchy actually means. That there's misinformed or crude stereotypes about this. Yeah, anarchy has its roots in education. Over the last 100 years, the work of Emma Goldman has advocated the liberation of the mind. The liberation of the mind from doctrine. The liberation from the shackles and restraints of the government. The liberation of the human body. Anarchy stands for a social order based on free grouping of individuals coming together for the purpose of producing real social wealth. Are we anarchists in here? In fact, education anarchy could be defined by Muller, recently writing in 2012, that it is an apprenticeship in freedom and not submissiveness in order to develop free and critical minds, and in pursuit of this, cultivate the values of liberty, equality, and solidarity. Folks, it's time that we shake up the education system. There's a critical mass of educationists. There's a critical mass of teachers. There's a critical mass of early years practitioners. There's a critical mass of schools and other thinkers and psychologists and wonderful people like you. What happens if we continue to shake something got to give? Just to make sure we're still. And before anything explodes, so it's can be summarised very much like that. And somebody seems to have come up with a website. I don't know who they are. that advocates education around educationality, quite like where we put a plus in the corner there, just the educational aspect there. Yet, going back to 1975, Cantor suggested we need a thorough investigation of humanity's inner world to rival and surpass space exploration in interest and importance. From a hermeneutical perspective, at a time of monumental social, economic, and political change, one could question the exponential budgets that are being spent pursuing the explosion, pursuing making particle accelerators, musing on the theoretical edges of the universe. So, apart from the huge budgets being invested in maths, Kant was saying, but we should focus on the wonder essential to us, the wonder of being human, the wonder of human being. Thank you.
Indeed, a stimulating presentation. Thank you. And maybe we need to rename the section. Or transverse anarchy. I mean, everyone is difficult to turn transversal psychology with these people. Any questions?
Stunningly silent.
I want to pick up on something that your participants already picked up on, which is the notion of a value-free education, which they seemed much less keen on than any of the other aspects, and strikes me as neither possible nor perhaps even desirable. And why and
I think
how that might happen.
Appreciating that we exist in a wider society, a wider culture, that the cultural tensions, no matter what happens to children for 4.5 hours of contact time during a single day, even though they're in the building for about 6.5 hours, that there's, let's say, another 18 hours outside where the rooms of whatever's going on around there. So they're saying that we can only affect a small notion of this, and that there's wider aspects. It links to the Uri Broth and Brenner's work of how there's many different systems impact on children and childhood. So they're saying, yes, we'd love to have it, but we don't think that in taking education in a wider sense, we can really advocate that. Sorry, is that an answer to your question, if I've understood it?
I guess. So it's a pragmatic.
Pragmatic, yes.
Quite sure what my question is, but there's one in here somewhere. I'm a primary school teacher as well, so
I'm
totally with you on everything that you said about the transpersonal aspect, and actually I would say my feeling that my success of being a teacher is largely based on the relationships that I'm able to build up with children, more so than any particular delivery technique, I think. I think that's really fundamental. But and I know some amazing primary school teachers who really are extremely, extremely talented. I suppose my question is, we can't sort of radically change the education system overnight. So what I want to know is, like, it is how it is at the moment.
Yes.
And, you know, there are a lot of teachers out there that are absolutely frazzled, who are working, you know, ridiculously long days, you know, drowning under, you know, swathes and swathes of unnecessary paperwork. Not that I have a soapbox here at all, but
and it's all his fault.
Yeah.
I'm
studies. So I suppose my question is, how can transpersonal be? How can we get it in there now?
Well, Chloe, that's a wonderful question, because this is why I've come to this conference to say, look, I've got an idea. I'm trying to merge my professional and my research interests. And I haven't got a clue where I go. I can go to the conference. I can have subtle conversations. And I'm wondering whether the next step is to engage also with the social media or even the television media and to try and advocate, but without sounding like, I don't know if the technical terms are fruit loop or but you know, how can this be then packaged in a way that resonates with people without it seeing just like some, excuse my language, some quack psychology, some fad. A textbook I'm working on at the moment has got a theme that's called applied psychology for teachers. The theme is you've got to know your own philosophy first, you've got to know yourself before you can dip into that toolbox and take that tool, that technique, etc. So, arguably, as writing it, I'm trying to subtly weave in the notions of transpersonal, the notions of the themes that we share as practitioners, because I know that I've come across on perhaps an overly negative side of education, but I'm with you, there are a critical mass of teachers, of students, of colleagues who want to shake off the shackles and to stand up and say, just let me teach. So I'd really welcome any dialogue now who's got any ideas or avenues where this could go, and perhaps even have a subsection of the transpersonal psychology section of education, or transpersonal education, I don't know. So it's a start point, I'm saying, so but I'd welcome further discussion. Thank you.
Of course, when it comes around to like so many other things, is the integrity and the presence of transpersonal psychology.
Indeed.
You know, it's our responsibility in a sense. You know, there's application and research and, if you like, theory. And there's this dynamic interaction between all of them. And so it's not as if transpersonal psychology has to get its act together and then someone like you can say, oh, well, let's put it into here. That's all part of the same process.
It's a true marriage, and personally, I just say my own guilt of muttering under hushed tones, but less than transpersonal psychology. But yeah, I've got to stop almost being self-effacing with that, being proud of that. But we're talking about joint offices between transpersonal psychology and perhaps education, and all those other things, because these themes, as the words are already noted, that they do resonate. But people don't know about the area, and so as soon as they do, I think they'll manage it.
We have our media representatives working.
Right.
As soon as. it raises a question that I was interested in, but it's not really on your major presentation, so it's a question in parentheses. But when you had the diagram of humanistic, positive, and transpersonal, you raise the issue of the tensions between them, and I think that is the question: what are those tensions? Why are there tensions? And well, I've got some thoughts, but it's a question for you. I'm interested in as well.
Yeah. Obviously, there's something that 10 years ago, psychology to its own roots of humanistic, but it's still very interesting that the UK has got a transpersonal psychology section, and to my knowledge, there isn't elsewhere. I've got a concern about the, as I was talking about forest schools and the way they've been taken out of context, I feel the same may be happening with positive psychology. The government were talking about developing a 4-question measure to assess if people are happy. First question was, are you happy? Can't remember the other three, there must be something else. About a year and a half ago, that was quite top of the news. And if we are continuing to be, this notion of positive, then excuse my ignorance of positive psychology to anyone out there, but we'll put my hand on myself, the most ignorant person about positive psychology. But I believe that most of my learning experiences have come from being an idea of the cycle, and finding the strength to move on and to progress beyond. And I think that we want to embrace both of those in a true, maybe a true Taoist sense, going back to Elias speaking from it. And to maybe have shared conferences between positive psychologists, between the transpersonal psychologists, and say, come on, let's have a conversation. Let's talk about our areas of sympathy. The core textbook at the moment is positive psychology for teachers. There isn't any transpersonal psychology for teachers, so everyone's got a chapter in there.
But again, there's progress in this. Well, Harris,
yes,
he's just currently producing a handbook of transpersonal psychology.
Yeah.
And I think you mentioned also that he has a contract to produce I can't remember the title, but it's in the area of applications of transpersonal psychology. So, you know, and these are important ways to put it out there and to clarify where the boundaries really do lie.
Actually, peer reviewed his proposal, I'm saying there should be a transpersonal education chapter, but I don't have a
You've said that to
him? I said it in the peer review process, blind peer review process.
Right. Yeah, you're blind. Salome. Okay, any other questions?
I've got a shovel over here. Terribly sorry.
No, don't apologise. I'm almost actually doing a transpersonal psychologist at heart. It's just that academically I've ended up going down the positive psychology route. But my sense after completing the MA in positive psychology is that I've really felt that positive psychology should actually sit within transpersonal psychology as opposed to the other way around. Which is very, very controversial.
Please say that again. I'm sorry, I don't know your name. It's
Sasha.
Thank you, Sasha.
And I think that maybe the differences are that positive psychologists somehow. Are you recording this? Off the record. I think the differences might be epistemological or science-based.
Yes.
It's the age-old argument of, like, is psychology a science and all of that kind of business. And methodological. So I think positive psychology is trying too hard to be a very hard-nosed science.
Yes.
And I think that's where the difference lies, because transpersonal psychology is still seen or perceived as being a bit fluffy. But yeah, that's my perception.
So, well, thank you very much. And sorry for my previous I welcome you and comment, so thank you.
So if anyone is interested in further conversations around the links between positive psychology and transpersonal psychology, I'll be very interested. So.
Thank you, Sasha.
Intrinsic motivation, why is it extrinsic? How can that be a fair? You know, are we now going to go back to doing what we're told again just for the hell of it? Well, you know, it's about that's not the things that I think people will recognize.
I think this is where I'm trying to weave the theme, so if we're talking about something like the intrinsic motivation, etc., then I can bring in the subtleness of the transpersonal and still make it very clear.
Can I draw to a close? And again, thank you very much.